Between the time when wargamers played with chainmail and the rise of the Wizards of the Coast, there was an age of gamers. And unto this, Gygax, destined to bear the crown jewel of TSR upon a troubled brow, to show you all how to roll for initiative.
The Roll for Initiative Podcast, issue number 86, volume 2. I am DM Vince, sitting alongside DM Nick.
Hi, everybody.
Who is back this week? Yay!
Yay! Almost didn't make it. More on that later.
Yeah. And DM Will.
Hey, what's up?
DM Matt is off on a shoot, actually. He said he was going to be off doing an independent film with one of the Estevez brothers, or the Sheen brothers, I should say. Not Charlie and not Emilio, so I guess one of the younger brothers was involved with the film, he was saying, so he was all excited about that.
Raul Sheen?
What's his name?
What's his name, Raul? Or?
I don't remember what he said his name was, but it was, I never heard of the name before.
Well, have any of them ever amounted to anything in the movies?
Charlie has. Emilio was a big actor during the 80s.
Oh, heck yeah. Emilio Estevez's best film ever was like Repo Man.
Yeah, and then Martin Sheen, the father.
Yeah.
He was a big actor in the 80s. Probably 70s too, right?
Yeah, Apocalypse Now was probably one of his biggest films.
Oh, yeah. Wow. That's the only one. He's a one-shot wonder.
No.
No.
Trust me. The Sheen family's in there.
Yeah.
Well, it's not only that one screwball Charlie we can do without him.
All right, so Nick, you haven't been around for a little while. What were you doing?
Yeah, you know how it is. I got kids. Summer's coming. We want, you know, and summer's here. Want to do stuff. For Mother's Day was busy. Then Father's Day, a few conventions going on with you folks and everything. But yeah, today I almost didn't make it out. I failed my con check earlier today.
Ooh. I gotta hear this.
I was working outside on the house. I was going to. We had our house painted a couple of months ago, and before that, I had to take a. We have one of these retractable awnings. I had to take it off the house, and I was going to reattach it now. And one of the things on my honey-do list. So I'm out there and everything, and I started to get a little. My head was pounding. I was starting hard to hear and everything. I sat down and like it was heat exhaustion. I almost passed out in the bathroom. It was very scary.
As long as you're okay, you're here.
Thank God the wife was there. She's like, okay, just lie down. I'm going to get you some water. You'll be fine. She has like, she goes, I'm going to take your blood pressure and everything. She has one of these little electric blood pressure cuffs and everything. She's like, your blood pressure is like kind of low. Oh, that's not good. So, yeah, I laid down for a little bit. Drink some water, but I'm okay. I'm alive, but almost passed out. Failed the con check. I was out for several rounds, folks.
Well, as long as you made it back.
Yeah, I'm good now. I'm okay. So, yeah, that was the highlight of my day.
How was your Father's Day?
Oh, that was today?
Yeah, that was today. Yeah, it was earlier this afternoon.
How was Father's Day?
Father's Day was it was all right. We went camping, and then we came back and we experienced Marine Week out in Cleveland, Ohio. The whole Marine Week was really fun. We got to go on the last couple of days. We got to see the Marines do an amphibious assault on downtown Cleveland.
Wow.
Yep, that's the good stuff.
Precursor to the things to come? I have no idea. Maybe they're getting ready for the zombie apocalypse. Who knows? But
I'm ready.
Yeah, it was kind of weird, though, because the city kind of dropped the ball on it when they were letting people in because they didn't expect the massive crowds. I mean, there was thousands of people there. And for a while, they were like, before you get into the, it's a, like a gated off area, you know? And people were trying to bring in, water just from themselves, like bottles of water, and they're making people dump their water out before they get in. And then all the vendors ran out of water. And all these people were so thirsty, people were like, there's no drinks to get. All the vendors ran out of water. And the city wasn't providing, so the USO give the water that they had for the Marines. The Marines donated their water to the folks out there in the crowd.
Aww.
Which was really cool.
Gotta love the Marines.
There you go.
Semper Fi.
Yeah.
Well, it sounds like you had a great time.
Yeah, and game night last night, we've been playing Hackmaster, and that's been fun. My thief is in a thieves' guild now. I didn't have to kill anybody in the party to do it.
Yeah.
So, I don't know if I said this, but my thief's name is, if anybody knows the reference, his name is Woodchuck.
No, I don't know the reference.
Don't get the reference, huh?
Nope. I think of the animal.
I'll leave it out there. If anybody out there in our listening audience knows what character I'm referencing to, let us know.
Let me guess, is it like somebody from Top Gun or something?
No. No, it wasn't Maverick and Woodchuck. It was Maverick and Goose.
Oh, okay.
And, that's pretty much it. I think, next month we might do a one-shot of something, probably Call of Cthulhu. Then after that, probably back to the first edition game.
Will.
Yes.
What have you been up to?
Yes.
Nothing.
Okay. All right.
No. Not same old stuff and everything. Just, getting everything ready for PaizoCon next month. I got this adventure I got to write. I actually invested in Diablo 3 this weekend, played that a little bit, and I wrote down a lot of good ideas for possible adventures for our next year's PaizoCon and some other cons that I'll be running games at next year. So I'm looking forward to that. And
How is Diablo 3? I haven't gotten it yet, so.
Well, let me just say this. Blizzard really blew it. They blew it. Don't get me wrong. The storyline is absolutely stunning. I like the storyline. They always had a good storyline.
Oh, yeah.
The problem is, if you have no internet connection, you cannot play this game.
Right.
That right there is the worst concept ever for a game of this nature.
They're trying to do like the Microsoft Steam thing, but their own version of it.
Oh, they're like doing like Steam.
Yep.
Yeah, everything has to go through online with them, and I find that disgusting. I'm not playing World of Warcraft. I'm not playing any of that other crap. Keep it away from online. Keep it away.
There's no single player mode?
There is a single player mode. There is a single player mode. However, in order to play the game, it has to be via, what do they call it again?
It's a connection.
What is that thing called? BlizzardNet?
Yeah. No.
It's via...
Oh, ArenaNet, right?
Well, no. What do they call it? BlizzardNet or whatever it is? You have to play it through that function. Yeah. So
you have to connect.
That's weird.
Yeah. You have to connect.
No,
to
it's actually stupid. That was what they really, really messed up. Good game. Decent game. Great graphics. Awesome story. But the whole way around it was just terrible. Terrible, terrible.
Yeah. I'd rather just wait for Torchlight 2 to come out and play that.
Wow.
Yeah, so besides that, I'm just getting all the good storyline stuff off of there. I'm getting some interesting names for other things. I'm not going to say anything else about that. But overall, good to go. And then what else am I doing? Still doing my regular casting and molds because now I'm working on doors. I'm working on a lot of doors right now because these doors are a pain in the rear end. And I'm going to be posting pictures here real soon of exactly what I'm talking about as I'm constructing these things here.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, but overall, I don't know what else is really going on. That's about it.
Yeah, I tried the beta of Diablo 3, and I remember it being pretty cool. But when they announced that you had to be online to play it, I was like, what? No way.
Yeah, that's kind of bizarre.
And they dropped the ball on that big time because all those people that purchased it and they got it, and they couldn't play it until West Coast hit the same time.
Wow. Yeah. There's some other issues going on, too. And again, I'm not a fan of their auction house. They have an auction house thing on there. So let's say you find this very phenomenal legendary item. This, it goes from common, rare.
Yeah, like most online games.
To legendary.
Yeah.
If you find a legendary, put them on the auction house. People selling stuff for like 1.2 million gold. And I'm thinking like, dude, I ain't playing that long.
Yeah, I know.
And it's, I don't know. Like I said, it's good to see Diablo 3 come out. Has some good things about it, but that online thing, that was it. I'm done with that.
And they dropped the ball on the day one afterwards, like the servers all went down, so no one was able to play.
Oh, wow. Just the whole fiasco with them. I don't know what's going on with them anymore.
I mean, their name is Blizzard. They're all over the damn map, so.
Well, yeah, and you know what? And then, you know, they still got two more expansions for StarCraft to come out, knowing that there'll probably be another expansion after that, you know, to talk about the secret alien race that's supposed to pop up sooner or later. So.
Yeah, plus they still have World of Warcraft expansions coming out.
Yeah, well, once they went to the Fighting Pandas, that's it. I'm done with that. Yeah.
You want to be Fighting Panda? Well, no.
No, thank you. I'd rather go ahead and ride around on My Little Pony with wings than play a Fighting Panda.
You heard it here first. Will wants to play My Little Pony. Anyway.
Okay, then.
So what I've been doing? What have I been doing? I don't
know. What you been up to?
You know, cruising the web, watching people make fun of me, things like that. You know, the usual stuff.
Oh, okay.
Let's see. Playing in... We finished up Fin Fang Foom last night.
Oh.
Finally, but the audio was just... I guess Skype was really bad. So I kept repeating myself. I had to keep repeating myself for people to hear me. So the audio... Yeah. I'm debating on releasing it or not, because the way I was talking, I was like... All right, you hit. I had to say it like that just so they can hear me at one point. And I was getting frustrated, so I don't know if I would want to bother playing it up or not. And we're pretty much done. Now we're going to be playing Marvel Super Heroes.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Nice.
So that should be fun. We had fun playing it at the North Texas RPG Con, so we want to continue playing it again.
Oh, you probably know about that website then out there.
Classic Marvel?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a good website to go to. Yep.
Heck yeah. Got everything.
Yeah, and it's legal, too.
And it's legal, yeah, because apparently when WotC bought the rights to everything that TSR had, they left out Marvel Superheroes in Marvel Superheroes Advance. So it's like, public domain. Woohoo.
I don't understand why they didn't buy them, but whatever. That's their loss, so.
Yeah.
I guess they didn't care. Whatever. Dumb move. Now, Margaret Weiss has the rights to Marvel Superheroes now.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway. So let's see. We have any announcements? No, right? No announcements.
Well, the good thing is, though, that we do, the reprints are coming out next month.
Yay! Finally, I can get my reprints.
Yay. Is actually coming out, or are they?
Yeah, so thus far, right now, that the release date is still the release date is still July.
Goody.
I wonder if it's going to be because I saw them on Amazon too. The reprints too. Someone finally put links up on Amazon.
Huh.
So you can actually buy it off Amazon through certain stores.
Oh, okay.
Anyway,
it's a little bit easy.
Why don't we head into Sage Advice if we have nothing else?
Let's do it!
Master! Master! They're at the gates again! Master! It looks like another band of adventurers!
Adventurers? Again? Always the same. Coming to me for Sage Advice.
Sage Advice this week. We have two emails, but to get to Sage Advice, you go right to rfistaff@gmail.com, or you can do a voicemail, 570-865-4210, the hotline.
Hotline, all right.
Yeah. First one comes in from DM Alex. He writes, "Dear RFI crew, I have looked everywhere in the DMG for actually rolling for initiative and have not come up with..." Yeah, he emphasized that, so that's why I didn't know. "Not coming up with anything. Gygax does not go into lengthy details about weapon speed, surprise..." Oh, he does go into weapon speed, surprise, and other factors that modify initiative. "I've always played with rolling initiative as 1d10 or 2d6. Before factoring in numbers, and frankly, I've never used weapon speed, only dexterity as a modifier. So what's up with this? Am I missing something in the rules about rolling, or is it just Gary's rambling about weapon speed, the crux of what initiative should be? Thanks, guys. Big up to Bismarcky." Well, if you look on page 104 in the Player's Handbook...
Yep, page 104. There you go.
It says, each side rolls 1d6 and goes first, the highest side rolls win first. Unless that's the answer I can come up with.
Yep. Now, for his way that he's doing it, though, it's perfectly fine.
What page did you say that was on?
104 in the player's handbook.
Oh, in the player's handbook. Oh, okay, okay, okay.
What did you think I said? DMG?
No, I thought that's what. If he's looking for initiative, that's where I go to. I go to the DMG.
Yeah, it's more plainly listed out in the player's handbook for some reason.
Yeah, in the player's handbook, yeah.
It is in the DMG, though. I'm trying to remember where, though. Because we had this discussion a while ago.
Right.
We did part of a show on this.
You can use D10, and I think you can use 2D6. I don't see why not, right?
Yeah, you can use a D10. That's what I use for my game. I use a D10 for initiative. It's per individual.
Have you used 2D6 before?
I can't say I have. I'm not familiar with that method. I can't see why you couldn't. Whatever method works, as long as you're consistent. That's all I've always said.
I think he wrote 2D6 because it says both sides roll, and you take 2D6.
Oh.
It actually looks like he says roll 2D6, but it's not. I think it says take 2D6, and each side rolls, and the higher the 2D, 1D6 wins. Or something. It looks confusing, I know that.
Okay.
But anyway, thank you.
If you're looking for the DMG, it's on page 61.
There we go. Bismarck Union Rescue.
There we go. Yep. Combat encounters, combat initiative. Here you go.
And what does it say? Roll 1D6.
And it says...
each side will roll D6.
Determine if each party is surprised. Determine distance. The parties are unsurprised or equally surprised. Determine initiative on that round. It doesn't say exactly what dice that you use.
Right, the player's
handbook. I think they're assuming that you have the player's handbook.
Yeah.
And, well, actually, if you continue on page 62. Mm-hmm. Yeah, boy. D6 is rolled. It's right there, page 62.
There you go.
Surprise, blah, blah, blah. Again, a D6 is rolled, and scores for the two parties are compared.
Yep.
The higher the two rolls says, possess the initiative for that melee round. So, it's right there, my friend, page 62, under initiative, under that particular paragraph.
Okay, well, there you go. Thank you.
You're very welcome.
Okay.
But if he's more than, if he's comfortable using D10 or however he's doing it, that's fine. As long as you are consistent. And as far as weapon speed's concerned, I know, I'm pretty sure I read this over a few years ago. Gary Gygax said that when he was like, list of things that I shouldn't have put in the game along with psionics was weapon speed factor.
Uh-oh. Will's burning up in his
chair.
I don't
understand his concept on that, but I think that was a total mistake when he made that comment.
That, and also the when you have the whole chart for weapon versus armor's types, the modifiers there. That's another thing that nobody uses.
That's correct. I use that.
Yeah, of course you do.
I'm a firm believer in that, though. I am a firm believer in weapons versus AC.
Why?
Protect the armor.
And why is that, Will?
It just makes sense.
Oh, that's a great argument.
It just makes sense. No, it's just too much damn bookkeeping. Yeah. That's just me, though.
Actually, you know why I actually do that? I'm going to tell you why. Because when you play Chivalry and Sorcery and Hardmaster, if you know those rule sets, I mean, it absolutely makes sense. That's just what I'm accustomed to. But then again, like I said, you know, hey. But you're right, though. It's a lot of paperwork for some people. But for me,
it's just one less thing I want to look up for combat. I want to keep combat initially as fluid as possible.
Yeah, you are and everything. But all it does is, you know, nothing wrong with initiative. It's a good question, you know, on the initiative. Because initiative is done so many different ways. And me and Vince talk about it back and forth and everything. It's a constant war that will never end. But, I mean, it comes down to it, though. Plate mail is just like chain mail and it's like leather and so on. When it comes to weapons. And, yeah, it's all good, though. Keep it simple.
Yeah, that's right. stupid, right? Keep it simple and stupid?
Yeah. His or method. Keep it stupid simple.
Yes. There you go.
You can do that, too.
All right. Our last email.
Don't know how far you're going to go with that, but okay.
No, like I said, the things that you said on initiative is correct. It's a D6.
Yep.
Yeah, and sometimes I've done D6 reverse, like the lowest side goes first.
Oh, yeah. See, that doesn't make a difference, really. Like you said, how you do it, that they can go either the one with the highest or with the one with the lowest, just invert the things on the surprise effect. Surprise makes a big issue on that, but that's all good.
Well, I was done surprise normally, but when initiative goes, I would do the lowest first and add the spell segments to it.
Okay, yep, good to go.
Just to be a little bit different there.
You know, one day we'll have to discuss initiative just a little bit and talk about how ties work. Because ties are very interesting as far as when it comes to initiative.
I just go, tie goes to the player and let them go.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, because that's what it becomes. Everything is simultaneous. That's going to be awesome.
Anyway, last email. Let's get this done.
What's that?
Comes from Kestrel from the forums of osrgaming.org/forum. Oh, sorry, I was imitating the guy from The Simpsons. Anyway. The Reverend. Hi, guys. Really enjoyed the last show where you answered all those emails. Hopefully you'll have the time to answer mine as well. I've been having some trouble with how much experience to award in my regular game. The players are currently in the Moat House section of Temple of Elemental Evil.
Yay!
Could you, I know you both have run through that many times.
Oh, yeah.
Could you please explain the system as written and then share your methods of rewarding experience? Thanks for the great material and keep up the great work, Kestrel.
Well, go for it, Will.
Go to page 85 of the DMG, and there's four simple steps. Now, the fourth one is an exception, and so it all depends. There's some other things you need to take into consideration. One, kill all the monsters. Once all the monsters are killed,
that helps.
Then you total up the total experience points for those monsters. Okay, all surviving characters, everyone that's alive, and this is where it gets a little tricky here, because it states specifically in the DMG, quoting now, because I am reading from the book, I don't want to sound boring to anyone out there, I forgot who said that, they said I was boring anyway, but it says, all surviving characters who took part, no matter how insignificantly, in slaying the monsters are totaled. I don't like that too much and everything, but in any case, all surviving player characters... then you divide the number of characters with each by the XP. The XP total is divided by the number of characters, each getting an equal share. So if you have 1,000 experience points and you have 10 characters that participate in the combat, no matter how insignificantly, they will get, how much do they get? 100 experience points each.
Okay.
That's it. That's just for monsters. We haven't discussed yet how to do treasure or the gold and so on. Now, if I remember correctly, is it one experience point for each gold piece?
Yes.
Yeah, or you can scale it up or down depending on your game.
Yeah, that's true. I believe by the rule, though,
It's one for one.
One for one per gold.
Yes.
So that there we go. Now we're looking on that. So again, you will divide that equally by all the people that survived the fight.
Mm-hmm.
And the same thing applies with everything else, treasure and so on and so on. Now, let's take a look at those other things that might come into play. I believe, I don't have the PHP in front of me right now, if character classes have the prerequisites, the proper prerequisites, I believe they get an extra 10%. Am I correct?
Either 10 or 15%.
I want to say it was 10% for some reason. Yeah. I don't know why, but I'm just saying 10%. You got that there too as well. And let me think, where else would experience come from? I think that's it.
Magical items.
Okay, now that's the funny part. Mm-hmm. If you find a magical item, let's say it's worth 1,000 experience points, you divide that by 10, everyone's going to get 100. Now, No, I'm sorry.
That goes to the character who possesses the item.
Yeah, who possesses the item. I'm sorry.
I was like, whoa.
Yeah, I was going back to the gold again. Yeah, it goes to the character that possesses the item only, not to everybody.
Right, and they have to possess the item, not sell the item.
That's right, exactly. So, what about if they can use it, or if they cannot use it?
I think that you have to hold on to it, I guess, and make use of it somehow.
See, that's my concern right now.
For me, if it's a magic item, say, for example, it's a sword and a magic user for some reason has it, I do not award them the experience points for it because they cannot use it.
Right. There you go. And that's a key thing right there. I just wanted to make sure we was clear on that.
So that's just an example on that. Now, some DMs do it a little bit differently as far as experience for myself. This might sound strange to some people. I think we talked about this before. I do not award experience points for gold pieces. To me, I just don't understand that concept for awarding experience points for money. It just doesn't equate to me. But I do award experience points for, you know, magic items and monsters killed. Or I should say monsters defeated. You don't necessarily have to kill the monster to defeat it. So that's how I do it. Maybe my, you know, I know there's some DMs that do it that way too, but you know, by the book, yeah, it's one per one on the gold piece kind of thing. Now, one thing I do recommend when you're going through this adventure is to save yourself a lot of bookkeeping before, you know, doing all the experience points. Figure the experience points before the adventures for the encounters. Is it for at least the monsters?
Yeah,
that's what I do. I go through the book and I'll write down, or you know, put it on the computer here. I'll have it on notebook or something like that. Encounter area 5, you know, blah blah blah. And I'll look up the experience point chart there, and then boom, done. And then when it comes to that time when you're actually when your players are going their characters are going through the adventure, you don't have to do all that figuring after the fact. You're not wasting time during game time to factor in all those experience points. Now, things like the bonus experience points, like for certain character classes, now that's on the player's side, because that's going to be variable. That's going to be 10% or 15% of where the total XP is. So you can't figure that beforehand, but you just got to remind, you know, players of certain character classes, they might get an XP bonus. So, but other than that, yeah, I highly recommend figuring out experience points for the encounters beforehand, before the game session.
Okay, cool.
That's all I got to say about that.
Now, there's a couple things I want to bring up real quick, like on this.
Okay.
I do pretty much by the book. Now, there are some issues. I'm going to tell you, I will give them experience for gold, and there's a reason why.
Well, that's okay. That's fine.
Now, but let me explain why in this sense, though. Because when you have the players going through against the giants, let's just use that module. Okay, that's a prime example of a module that has some issues. By the time the players get through it, and I got to write down somewhere the total experience point value of that dungeon, and if you get every piece of treasure out of there, and if you kill every monster in there, it doesn't have that much experience points. I'm going to tell you, it does not. I do not see how player characters can level up in that place, to be honest with you.
Don't you award experience for role-playing and funny statements and things like that?
You can do it like that, or let's say they get into a combat, the first room, they kill 2 hill giants.
Okay.
They were the ones that are drunk.
Yeah,
and I forgot how much hill giants are worth right now and everything. But instead of dividing it by the number of players, each person gets that amount equally. So if the account is worth 1,000, everyone gets 1,000 experience points of vice dividing it by the number of player characters. And people say, well, that sounds like a lot of experience. Well, let me tell you something. I don't see how a party of 8th level characters can level up high enough, fast enough to go to D1, 2, and 3, and then Q1. Because it's just the math does not make sense. It doesn't. And I challenge anyone out there to look it up. And like I said, I guarantee you, you're going to find out that I got to put it online instead of show you. And you're going to be shocked at what it really is worth. It's not worth that much.
Oh, how many? Well, yeah, it was the first against the Giants is starts 8th level, right?
Yes, 8 to 12, actually.
Yeah. Okay. So let's say they all started at 8th level. Now, I would say that there's a pretty good chance by the end of that module, they're going to advance at least one level, maybe even two.
And that is it. I think at the bare minimum, they can go at least two. Depending on which character class, one can go three, and I believe that was the Thieves. I don't know who has the better...
Thief XP progression is pretty fast.
So that's what the big issue is right now. Is, and also, I also want to tell you about experience points as we're bringing this up now. Remember, when you kill a monster, they have a base experience point value, but do not forget to give them the additional experience points for the number of hit points they have.
Right, number of hit points. They might have special abilities that you get more XP for. So, yeah, you're absolutely right.
For example, the troglodyte, for example. Mm-hmm. A simple troglodyte is worth 36 experience points plus 2 experience points per hit point.
Right. Plus, it has the special abilities. It has that musk, that stench. That's worth extra experience points. A special ability with troglodyte was 2 hit dice, right?
I believe it is. Yeah, it is.
So that's an extra 15 experience points right there per troglodyte.
Right.
So you've gone from 35. Actually, if it's 2 hit dice monster, so it's 20 basic XP value plus 2 hit points per 2 XP per hit point plus another 8 for the special ability. So you're getting up there around 35 to 40 hit XP per monster.
Yeah, so yeah, that's very important if you all catch up on those kind of things.
Yep.
Okay.
I think we got it.
Yeah.
I think so.
I usually know more experience based on, the monsters to kill, obviously. I used to keep a running tally of individual experience.
Yes.
Because that's how I was taught with the great Joe DM. That's how he did it.
The great DM, yeah. Joe.
But I found that to be too much, like you said, bookwork and paperwork. So I stopped doing that, and I just kind of give everyone the same amount of experience just to save me time. And
yeah.
I'm more about the story than the game mechanics. I mean, I make sure people level up and they fight generally what they're supposed to. But, I mean, every once in a while it's nice to throw things to kill them. So I don't award the gold per experience. If I do, I usually do it on a 1-5 basis.
Right. Yeah, and what I remember, I mean, at the top of my mind, I want to say overall, it's about 2.5 million experience points in G123 alone. If you divide that by 8 people, you're not going to get that much. You're not going to get much. And that's provided they find everything, which they normally don't anyway. They really don't fight everything.
Yeah,
and that's,
because the players always find the shortcut.
Right. And this is also assuming that they kill all the children monsters and all that. And, I mean, it just goes into it. It's so big time and everything, but the chance is highly unlikely. And you know what? We're not even talking about possible wandering monsters or using the wandering monsters on the chart.
That does, yeah, and that could boost it a little bit.
Oh, yeah, if it does, it's just a fraction. It's just a fraction. Yeah. A mighty fraction.
Yeah, that's what I mean, a little bit.
A bit. Yeah, so, yeah, just and a thought. Just, find what is good. Remain consistent. And that's another key thing that we brought up. Be consistent about the experience points and look at how it's going to level up the players. I mean, that's what's important.
Also, with me, with the gold and the magical items, you have to securely bring them back to a safe area.
That's absolutely correct. That is absolutely correct. When you find a ring of magic missiles, simply just putting it on your hand and using it is actually, you really can't truly claim the experience unless you go back.
Right. Now, the person said that they're going through Temple of Elemental Evil, right?
Right, yes.
Yes.
Okay, now that one might be a little bit more plausible as far as XP is concerned.
Right.
So I think that one might be okay.
I've run through the third edition version of the Temple of Elemental Evil.
Yeah.
And
against the Giants, it's the same way. And yeah. D1, 2, and 3 is the same, and so is Q1. It's not possible for you to get back to, home and everything each and every time you find a magic item. It's actually ludicrous to accept that. It's within a reasonable means.
Yeah.
Hmm. Okay. So I hope that answers your question. If not, just write us back and we'll try to further explain this. And maybe we'll do an episode on more awarding experience.
Yeah.
I don't think there's much more you can really dive into, but who knows. With the right questions, maybe we could. Let's head into the table manners.
Yeah, I remember back in the day, a fella knew how to judge a fireball on the fly and how far the cleric could push the undead he turned. I tell ya, with all these min-maxers and munchkins, metagame and power game, there's something missing that I'm here to learn ya. Now sit down and crack your book while I commence to teach ya some.
Table manners.
Okay, today's table manners. We are going to talk about the immortals. Now, I believe that the whole topic of today's show is about immortality. Am I correct?
Right. It's the two ways of playing immortality: being an immortal and having a character that lives on forever, pretty much.
Okay, then that makes it very easy for me, because I said we're talking about immortality, then we're talking about the mortals. I just rather play, you know, an undead creature, just be undead. But since we're talking about the immortals, that's a whole different story.
Yeah.
Now, for most people that don't know anything about the immortals, this predates first edition AD&D, if I'm correct.
Yeah, it goes back to the box set for Mentzer.
So that's Mentzer's box set, and I believe there was, is there two box sets?
Wrath of the Immortals was put out after
the Advanced.
Advanced was already out.
Yes, Advanced was already
out. The Rules Encyclopedia came out.
Right.
And then they came out with Wrath of the Immortals. I don't know if that was a box set or it was just a paperback.
One of them was a box set. And, you know, I apologize to everyone out there, because all my stuff, as far as you know, predating first edition AD, especially in that area, like the Wrath of Mortals, because I never used that material, is locked up in a box in a storage facility. And I wasn't going through another 60 boxes to try and find it. Mm-hmm. So what did I do is I went to the Rules Encyclopedia. And if you have the Rules Encyclopedia, it covers everything on Chapter 50 on who the immortals are, what the immortals are, how player characters become immortals, and so on and so on and so on. So let me start off. Who are the immortals? You know, it's kind of funny that when I look at this Chapter 15 and read on the immortals and everything, what are we actually talking about? Are we talking about gods? Are we talking about demigods? Are we talking about a completely different type of entity? And anytime, Vince, and y'all, if you got anything to say, please let, you know, just interrupt whenever you can.
Sure.
Okay, let's start off with the player characters. Let's start off with the player characters, and I'll work my way up on this topic.
Oh, yeah, here we go. I'm sorry, just to interject. Immortal Rules, that was a box set.
Yep.
That was set 5.
Right, Mentzer.
Regular D&D, and Wrath of the Immortals was just a separate book.
Right.
It wasn't, it was to be used with the D&D Rules Encyclopedia.
Right.
So we can get everybody, you know, we got all of our ducks in a row here.
I knew it was something like that. I just couldn't remember, because I know I have that stuff in a box, and there's no sense in me taking that out until I get my library all set up, my bookshelf. Anyway, let's talk about the PCs, because that's what's important, the player characters.
Right.
Okay, per the rules, all immortals at one time whatnot were mortals, so they could have died. In the Rules Encyclopedia, and I know it's in the Immortal box set, all that, and we talk about the Wrath of the Immortals or whatever the case may be, a PC, a player character, become an immortal, but they have to go through a certain, I can't even say how to say the proper word right now. Mm-hmm. There's a certain setup. There's a certain sequence of events that has to take place in order for them to become immortal.
Right, yeah, you're right, yeah.
Now, with all immortals, like I said, they once were mortal. They were just regular player characters, but the moment, the prerequisites, the moment they become 30th level...
36.
I'm sorry?
You're right, go ahead.
Yeah, they have to be 30th level. That's one of the prerequisites of them, you know, becoming an immortal. Then they got to find a sponsor. Now, this is the tricky thing. And, you know, then we have to go back to what are the role of the immortals in this DM's campaign, or which the players are playing in? Do the immortals, you know, do they interact with the player characters? Now, you know, this is kind of weird. When you read it, you see, like, this is the same old stuff dealing with gods and demigods and all that stuff and everything. I mean, do the gods really interact with player characters? And 9 times out of 10, they probably don't.
No, yeah.
And if they do interact, it's only through, you know, the legitimate, you know, casting of a clerical spells, druid spells, and all that kind of stuff. But that's not to say that, you know, DMs will say, well, you know what? You are a fighter. You're a wizard. You're a thief. Your gods do pay attention to what you do. You know, whatever the case may be, you know, you can have that kind of interactivity with the immortals, if you all get my drift.
Right.
But in most cases, it's plainly spelled out that the mortals typically do not interact with mortals, which is weird because when I read that portion about how the immortals deal with them, they have this law. Did you see that rule?
Yeah.
It's real simple. It's real similar to that in Star Trek with the, what do they call that? Where they don't deal with the, lesser.
Non-intervention
thing. Yeah, that, you know,
the prime directive
thing where they don't deal with them. And it's the same thing with immortals. The direct action against mortals is forbidden. So then how does a player character find a sponsor to become an immortal? Kind of difficult. So again, the DM has to look at, well, you have to go on a certain set of adventures and everything to get their attention. Now you find your sponsorship, if you get my drift on that. So then once they find that sponsor, they have to do a petition. And then after the petition, they have to do these tests. There has to be 7 of them, if I'm correct. There has to be 7 tests.
It's kind of like
and all of them have to deal with bravery, mercy and charity of the heart, wisdom, all those benevolent things. So again, it puts into play again. Automatically, it looks like, you know, they're assuming that these are good adventurers. What about evil campaigns? So just change those 7 tests around to something evil.
It's kind of like Jedi Trials.
Say again?
Like Jedi Trials.
Exactly. And like I said, the big thing that they harped on was that they don't all have to be combat related. It could be, you know, phenomenal role plan. So again, these are things that, you know, a DM has to, you know, plan well way in the future and everything and dealing with these players if they get this far. I mean, straight up, I'll be honest with you right now. It's kind of weird on this. Because per the rule cyclopedia, it specifically states that if a character reaches immortality, he must retire from the play game. Unless the campaign focus changes to follow the immortals, you know, and all that stuff. So, I mean, there's a lot of things that a GM or a DM has to take into consideration with all this. So first, the character gets the 30th level. I mean, like, wow. I don't know about you all, but I never got a character that far up, ever.
No, unless we started at level 30.
That's the whole point here. Here I am, getting my characters up to, you know, starting at first level or 0 level if you use the Arcana, where some of them can start at negative levels. And I don't even think I even got halfway to 30.
I remember us going from level 1, and finally we got to level 9, and we're just like, yeah, we just made ourselves level 25 so we can go for immortalhood.
That's the whole point. I mean, what is the chance of a player character actually getting to 30th level? So that's one of the key things I see here with, you know, we're talking about the immortals and, you know, going through immortality. Well, if you're going to go the undead way, that sure enough is probably the fastest way of becoming, you know, almost eternal. The other way is going the immortal thing, and it's a lot more harder. So then, you know, once you're on that path to immortality, you know, the character then has to choose, you know, these spheres of power. What kind of immortal are you going to be? I mean, you know, it just goes on and on and on. And I don't know how far you all have gone on this.
I played in a bunch of games for immortality.
I have never played in a campaign like that ever.
See, that's what I'm saying. So again, once the character gets all this stuff, that alone onto itself is going to take a long time. There's no way that, you know, y'all can get all these things done in one campaign. Honestly, I don't see it happening. It isn't like, how many tasks were there to Hercules?
How many what?
Tasks. Didn't Hercules have?
How many tasks Hercules have to do?
How many were there?
Oh my gosh.
I can't even remember right now for the life of me. See, I forget these things. But it didn't happen over a month. This happened over years, as I understand. Right. So this is what you're dealing with when you want this player character to become an immortal and do the 7 tests. So during this whole time, you know, he should be studying, or she or he, whoever's doing it, should study under the spheres of power. And then again, that all has to deal with what kind of mortal.
It's the 12 labors.
12 labors.
Here's a good idea. I think this is a really good idea when you brought up Hercules here. And he had to do his 12 labors, okay? He had to slay the Nemean lion.
Right.
Slay the nine-headed Lunarian Hydra.
Right.
Capture the golden hind of Artemis. Capture the Eretherian boar.
Yeah.
Clean the Augean stables in a single day. I remember that one.
That was fun.
Slay the Stymphian birds. Capture the Cretan bull. Yes, steal the mares of Diomedes. Obtain the girdle of Hippolyta, queen of the Amazons. Obtain the cattle of the monster Geryon. Steal the apples of Hesperides. And capture and bring back Cerberus.
I'm looking at like, wow.
And that was through his entire career.
That is correct.
He started as a youngin', I believe.
And at this time, he wasn't a god. He wasn't even a demigod. He was a regular person. He could have been killed. But through those 12, the Herculean labors, or whatever they're called, that's how he achieved the status of demigod.
Mm.
Because I believe he died, and then he was pulled into heaven, or into whatever
Olympus.
They call it. Am I not correct? Or did he just ascend into godhood?
I remember him being a demigod as the last thing. I don't remember how he became a god.
See, and that is the whole thing of, and I think that is probably the perfect example of taking a 30th level character, and once he meets the prerequisites, and once he finds his sponsor, I mean, how are you going to beat up on Hercules? His father was Zeus, of all people. I mean, there was a sponsor. Then, the test, which there were 7 tests, I guess, for Hercules, he had to go through 12.
Yeah.
He had to really prove himself and so on. And then from there on, he has lived in immortality from there on. I mean, since then.
Now, I think there's a couple ways you could go by this as far as the tasks that you have to perform.
Please proceed.
I think there's 2 ways you could go about this. One is when you reach the required level, then you have to start performing the particular tasks or the number of tasks.
Right.
Or you could go the other route and start doing the tasks through the career of the adventurer.
Right.
And I kind of look at the labors of Hercules as kind of the latter, not the former, you know, if you want to put it in game mechanics wise. He, you know, when he was a young man, he started his labors, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
So, to prove to the gods, particularly his father Zeus, that he was, you know, worthy of godhood in himself. And I think he could go that route. But I think that takes some pretty tricky planning on the DM's part, because you have to have an overall concept for the campaign that a player character or characters are going to reach godhood at a certain point, or at least attempt it.
Right.
Have any of you tried to become a demigod?
Never.
That's a good point, actually, because in the actual Deities and Demigods book, under the section of Divine Ascension,
on
page 11, right up front there, and there's some kind of guidelines or rules right in the Deities and Demigods that are very similar to what's in the Immortal series, and it kind of go along with that is, you have to... Now, they reach demigodhood, essentially.
Mm-hmm.
And then, after they complete their tasks, the first one they have to do is they have to reach a significant experience level that's way above average in their the general population. Then they have to have their ability scores raised so they could be at least on par with lesser demigods.
Mm-hmm.
Third, they have to find patronage of worshipers. Then they have to have a faithful and true follower. He has been a faithful and true follower to the alignment of his patron deity.
Yep.
And if you meet all those conditions, the character's deity may choose to invest the person with a certain amount of divine power.
Right.
And bring the character in the ranks of gods, celestial, or infernal servants. So, and then they become a demigod. And they can able to grant their worshippers spells up to fifth level to the demigods' clerics. Now, after that, I believe it says... Wait a minute. Let me reverse that.
Okay.
Let me back up a little bit. So they get these powers, but after several centuries, mind you, of superior service and gradual advancement, exceptional servants may be awarded the status of demigods. So they're not even demigods after they get certain divine abilities. They're, I guess, the lack of a better term. They're like the quasi deities out of the world of Greyhawk, like Keyword and Chaotum.
Yep, exactly.
They're like quasi deities or saints, if you will, to the gods.
There you go. That sounds better. I like that. That's a good analogy right there.
Now, after several centuries,
yeah,
of doing the good works or infernal works, depending on the alignment of the character in question, then they could become a demigod and then grant spells to their worshipers at least up to fifth level for their clerics, I should say. So
right.
And that's on the AD&D side. When you're talking the deities and demigods book. So it's really tough to even become a demigod. So
yeah, well, see, like, for example, and you talked about the experience points and the number of years it takes to do something. Prime example. See, once the character gets his sponsor, right?
Yeah.
He's got to create this gift. It's like a present to this sponsor. It's got to be like 25,000 gold or more and all this other stuff. Anyway, after that, the player character must then choose a path.
Right.
And the fourth path that they have designated in the rules cyclopedia was the Paragon, the Polymath, the Dynast, and the Epicuro. And the key thing is with all these things here is that each of them share the same prerequisites. So this keeps on going on. I mean, this, like I said, it matches up with Adidas Demon. This takes a long time to accomplish. So
right.
This character, I believe, is still mortal. Anyway,
right.
The character's adventures must gain him a specific amount of XP, which you mentioned before about the XP. The amount
right.
is 600,000 XP. For most classes,
okay.
But only 400,000 for the class the sphere favors. So the character has to choose these spheres. For example, the Polymath is the path to the sphere of matter. The Epic Hero, this is the sphere of thought. The Paragon is the sphere of energy. And the Dynast, like Dynasty, but it's a Dynast without a Y, is a
okay.
root to sphere time. And each of these paths, concentrate on one or two character classes. For example, the Sphere Time favors clerics and druids. And the Epic Hero, of course, favors the thief and mystic classes. The Paragon is for magic users, and the Polymath is for the fighter classes. So again, and then for that, and this goes on, they must complete a new quest to retrieve an artifact of lesser or greater magnitude, and so on. This takes several game years.
Right. Basically, it comes down to they make it very, very difficult if you want to try to make your player character an immortal.
Yeah, I mean, let me give you an example of how difficult it can be. For the Dynast, which is for the clerics and druids,
yeah.
The testimony, the character must create a realm with a population of at least 50,000 people, if a human, or 10,000 if demi-human.
Okay.
They must found a dynasty. And it takes 20 years of the character's life. So I'm not going to go through all these examples of what a character do. Well, maybe that, you know, I mean, it just takes forever for some of
yeah.
these things.
And just, I think some DMs, they might fast forward through some of that stuff too, you know.
Right.
you know, time passes.
When we played back in...
So the overall goal is that once he becomes an immortal, effectively, he has just achieved immortality.
Right.
Now, and then people say, yes, I'm immortal now. I can do all these other things. Okay, stop sign, red light, stop, freeze, whatever you want to do. That's not how it works. Then you have to go through the whole thing and how the immortals interact with mortals, their behavior, their statistics, and then, you know, how they look, how they manifest themselves in what form, because I'm unbeknownst to a lot of people. If you see them in their true form, that actually can strike down certain mortals.
Yeah, that's true.
So there goes a whole new rule set. Well, now that I'm mortal, what happens now? And now that comes to where I told you before, where it comes down that when a PC...
And I think you did say that once the player character becomes immortal, he does become an NPC, correct?
No, it's not true.
Oh, well, that's what the rule says, but however it carries on, unless the campaign focus changes to follow the immortals and their activities.
So it's an option for the DM to either, they can either retire the character or they can continue on. Okay.
Yeah. So the goal is, once my character reaches immortality, he is done, he's retired, then start back off at first level. Or the character can go on to provide the DM has something ready for it, create a campaign that focuses on how that immortal interacts with mortals and then moves on from there on. I mean, let's be realistic. We know that there was a lot of gods fighting other gods and other demigods fighting other demigods and so on and so on and so on. There's no reason this can't, you know, continue on. You know, when they reach that immortality phase.
An immortal could be whatever level they want to be. An immortal could be whatever level they want to be. They have an avatar they can send down.
Oh, yeah, well, of course, and everything. And, you know, and it didn't cover too much about that in the rules cyclopedia that I know of. I didn't read anything. I just didn't go into that further because I think that the goal was immortality. Once you become an immortal, you achieve that goal. So, but that's what I have as far as what the immortals about and what they consist of. Now, I looked online, I looked it through some of the Dragon Magazine archives and everything. They only covered, you know, to be honest with you, I couldn't find anything on the immortals themselves. However, they covered the rules, cyclopedia, and immortality. There was one Dragon Magazine covered that, nothing else was covered from there on.
Yeah.
Well,
so I suspect that a lot of this stuff here is going to be on the whim of a DM, and he's going to come up with a lot of good material if he plans on taking it further past the
this level. That's true.
I'll just be honest with you. I think the highest level that I ever achieved in, you know, the basic and expert and advanced sets was about 6th or 7th. I'm sorry, I take that back. I got the 8th level. That was the highest I ever obtained.
The highest level character I ever had was a 12th level magic user. Highest level ever. And I look at some of the immortal stuff. I'm like, wow. I think we all kind of did it. I think, well, not all, but I think most of us, when they saw the deities and demigods, we all like snuck to our friend's house. It's like, hey, let's go kill Thor with our characters, man. Okay, let's do that. So some of us probably have done that, but. You know, you got to go through the books, and there's some pretty specific rules. They're immortals. They're gods. You can't, like, really just go on to Asgard and start, you know, taking out Thor and Loki and the rest of the crew. And just, now I'm the God of Thunder because I killed him. No, that doesn't work that way.
We had a method.
Thor would have been the most worthless guy to go fight because you can't take his hammer. So that's something you can't take back to your fort or whatever to get the experience points.
I just cite an example.
No, I'm just messing with you and everything. I think, you know, when it goes into first edition AD&D, you know how Tiamat has an issue, I think, with Gilgamesh?
Yeah.
You know, they're constantly warring with another.
Right.
And that's when the player characters, if they get to a decent level where you get involved, whereas, you know, Tiamat and Gilgamesh both, you know, I mean, they're not involved themselves, but they have the mortal's fight form and everything. I think that's where it becomes the key thing.
And I think what it goes back to when we're talking about playing an immortal, I think you got to look at the whole campaign and how you're going to plan that campaign from beginning to end. Or to the end is, they're going to have a shot at godhood. You know, I'm going to shape the campaign and keep all these kind of things in mind. When the player characters go along, maybe these are the deeds that are going to count towards their godhood. You know? So, I don't know if this is something, you know, like player characters, like, you know, do on a whim. I was like, okay, I'm 30th level. I'm a god now. No, doesn't work that way. There are rules. There are parameters. There are certain guidelines.
You know what I would do? I would just tell the DM, you know what? I don't want godhood. Just make me a constellation in the sky, and then I'm happy.
There you go. You
know, that's constellation in the sky.
As far as playing, I think it'd be kind of cool when, like I said, when they reach a certain point and they kind of become quasi-deities, you know? That would be kind of interesting and kind of playing through that. That would be kind of fun. In my opinion, once you reach the actual demigodhood, you're pretty much done. I mean, you're granting spells to your clerics. You got a pretty decent following of mortals on, you know, for your side. After that, I mean, what else can you do?
I don't know.
Blow up the universe?
Yeah, and that's the whole key thing. And when they talked about this in chapter 15 of the Rules Cyclopedia concerning, you know, how it works, what do immortals do besides interact with the mortals? I mean, what more is there to do? What more? I mean, it comes to the time when a game finally comes to an end. It does come to an end. Time to move on.
I mean, what are you going to be like Emperor Ming and Flash Gordon? Clytus, I'm bored.
Yeah.
We have this little planet in a cascade system. It's called Earth.
Well, I think about that, Dave. You all watched Babylon 5?
Yeah.
What was that one emperor guy that thought he was a god?
They
killed him at the very end. You know what I'm talking about, that whole series where that one guy took over and he thought he was an actual god until they poisoned and killed him and everything. So I'm looking at it from that perspective and everything. And that would make for some interesting things, though, because if you do become an immortal, now in order to maintain the immortality, you have to have worshippers.
Yep.
Well, guess what? Another immortal doesn't like that stuff. So what does he do? He sends his cult out to go kill your worshippers. You see how that all works out, how it all plays out. You just have to go back into it and think about the longevity of a game when you become an immortal.
Right.
And you get in a whole other aspect where if I was going to do something like that, when you're talking about worshippers and your demigodhood or godhood or whatever you're at, you know, it reflects on, you know, this is as above, so below, that whole sort of thing.
Yes.
What happens in the heavens happens down below here on Earth in a kind of similar sort of way. So if you're fighting another demigod in amongst your, you know, pantheon, those worshipers might be going at it too in a certain way. So that'd be kind of interesting way to play it off. The whole as above, so below kind of thing.
Oh, yes, definitely.
So,
but that's about as much as I can cover on that part of the topic and everything with player characters and seeking and achieving immortality. It is definitely a long path.
Right.
Yes.
You guys have never tried to become immortals yourself, right?
No.
Oh, I hope to live forever, but
you've never tried to become demigods, right?
Yeah, I deal with the reality.
You've never tried to become demigods in the game either, right?
No. Never ever.
No.
Well, we came up with methods to become demigods. It was like a 3-step process. First you would petition one of the gods and become a messenger of the god and go around and do his works.
Yeah, basically like a saint.
Yeah, well, that was the next step. You become a messenger of the god, and you would have a bard with you, and he would sing about the acts that you've done. Once you've proven yourself, according to the DM, we never wrote that down how it would be, you would then become a saint of the god. And upon sainthood, you would start doing things in your own name, and then you would become a demigod. eventually.
I see. Okay.
Starting at level 20 all the way up to level 30.
Huh. That's interesting.
Yeah.
Pretty cool.
Anyway, so why don't we move on to game mechanics.
Oh man, what the heck is that?
Stand aside, you fool! I have a spell that will work here!
What do you mean I can't hit with that? All right, fine. Show it to me in the book.
Welcome to Game Mechanics.
And now we're going into Game Mechanics. Pretty much this portion of the show, we'll be talking more about immortality. But rules for controlling and controlling the immortals and the adventures for the immortals to have. Basically, what powers that they should have, what are they limited to, and is there someone that controls the immortals, like a god above the immortals, like a mortal would have gods, what's their higher power? So, Nick, you said you'd never really played Immortals at all. Or?
No, if you're talking about regular basic D&D, like the Wrath of the Immortals and the Immortal set, no, I did not get those. I'm not really familiar with them. But I am familiar with the rules as outlined in the Deities and Demigods book, for the most part. So, and I've never played like a demigod or anything like that in a campaign. I don't think I've ever, like I said, most I ever had was a 12th level magic user, and that was like, that was luck. So,
as far as powers go, it was pretty much whatever a god or a mortal can think of, they can do within PowerPoint reason.
Yeah.
I know Will spoke briefly about when they pick their sphere, they get so many PowerPoints involved with that. And when you, kind of like when you become an immortal, it's kind of like becoming level one again, but you're like a level one immortal. There's a couple stages to being an immortal.
Yeah.
And as you grow in immortalhood, you gain more power points, and as you gain more followers, you gain more power as well. So at the beginning, you can still do pretty much whatever you want, but you're limited in the scale power of doing it.
Right.
As far as, like, you can go and become an avatar, you can pick level whatever, one through whatever in your career that you were. And you can play as pretty much immortal. And if you die, you just become an immortal again. Nothing happens to you. Your body goes poof. But if you're an immortal fighting another immortal, it's kind of like playing Marvel superheroes at that point. You're using your power versus power. So if someone has more power than you, you're kind of screwed.
Yeah. Now, there are some, I know, within the Deities and Demigods book, just to give everybody kind of a baseline, there are some standard divine abilities, and that's right on page 8, right near the beginning of the book, that all demigods and gods have. They all can do command as the spell and comprehend languages.
Right.
Detect alignment.
Right.
Gate. Geas. Quest. Teleport. And true seeing. On some other things, like, and as far as saving throws, all gods and demigods have a saving throw of 2 in all their categories. The heroes, or saints, whatever you want to call them, they have all their categories is 3. So, yay! Yeah, awesome saving throws. The only way you can fail is if you roll 1.
Yeah, so, gotta be a certain percent chance you're gonna fail there.
Yeah, not much of a chance there. So,
yeah, certain though, like a 5%.
Yeah, it could happen. It could happen. You might fail that save against that fireball.
Maybe.
Just maybe. So, yeah, those are the standard divine beings' abilities. As far as, like, you know, other abilities, like we did talk in the previous segment about divine ascension and what is all involved with that. Basically, the four different things the player character has to do to really be in more detail when, like, we talk about, first, the character in question must have advanced to an experience level that is significantly above and beyond the average level adventure type characters in the general campaign.
Right.
So the examples they give, if the average level is something like 15th, then a character would have to be about 25 to 30th level to even be considered to go into Divine Ascension. So then you have to have your ability scores raised, again, through world-shaking magic on par with the lesser demigods. Now, and I like this section here, and there's that paragraph says, should such an act be lightly considered, remember that a wish spell is the most powerful magic that mankind can control, and such an average increase in abilities would literally take the power of dozens of wishes. Dozens of wishes, folks. Okay? Each use of that spell weakens the caster and ages him 3 years into the bargain, so they're not easy to come by. So, there's a price to pay to even go. Then you have to have the, sincere worshipers of your god, and make sure that you are, doing miraculous deeds. They've been witnessed. That whole kind of bard angle you talked about was kind of cool. That would be a good idea.
Well, how else would you get yourself known around town other than a bard singing your name?
Yeah, he'll killed seven giants in one blow. That sort of thing. And then you're on your way.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have to be of good and faithful to your god. And then we talked about how then, you do get some divine abilities, but you're not exactly immortal yet. And then after several centuries, then you can become a demigod. So that's kind of the mechanics in the Deities and Demigods book about it. So
we kind of talked about immortality and the gods and the demigods, right? Now, what about people that want to become demons or devils?
That's interesting. I guess if you want to go the opposite way, if you're worshiping an evil deity, or if you're in that evil campaign and you're dealing with demons and devils and other infernal creatures from the nether regions, I guess you just have to flip-flop it. I think it would be a lot more difficult. In my opinion, I think if you are worshiping evil gods, and again, in the Deities and Demigods, demons and devils are considered, the name demons and devils are considered lesser gods in their own right.
Right, right.
So they have worshipers. A lot of players forget that. A lot of DMs do forget that. That they are lesser gods as well. I would think they would want to try to off a player character who's trying to muscle in on their turf, if you get my drift.
Not necessarily, because they could always do the whole Prince of Lies thing and lead somebody on and give them a little bit of power and do the whole go with the dark side type thing and then screw them over at the end.
Basically, yeah, that would probably be the way to do it. You just have to be much more devious and conniving than the one that is your patron, in a way. So, yeah, I would think it'd be a lot more difficult.
I think you'd have to follow the whole, I hate to equate it to Star Wars, but the whole Sith Order philosophy of there's only two, there's a master and an apprentice, and to become the master, you'd have to kill the apprentice, you'd have to kill the master.
Yeah, you'd almost go that route. I would think so.
Yeah, that was the rule of two. There's a master and an apprentice, and to become the master, the apprentice has to kill the master.
Yeah, I would think that would be the way to go. I can't see any other way for it, because you're dealing with evil, and demons and devils and other creatures of that alignment, they're going to be very selfish and guard whatever powers that they have. And they're definitely going to guard it against some upstart mortals trying to come to the ninth plane of hell. You bet your lucky 20-sider they are.
Yeah. It's funny how you bring that up and everything, because, when I first talked about how you know, that, you know, you achieve immortality through being undead.
Yes.
I also forget that your Rimmer Vecna.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's a god. He's a god now himself.
Right, he's a demigod, isn't he?
Lesser god.
Oh, he's a lesser god.
Yeah. He's a lesser god right now, but I believe he's elevated much more higher.
Maybe he could be.
Yeah, because I have to take a look again. I haven't looked in D20 in a while. But, you know, the thing with demons and devils, though, you know, that's kind of weird and everything, how they kind of you know, gave them their, like, their semi-demigod status or whatever they are.
They are, yeah, they're lesser gods.
Yeah, they're definitely. I would think that, like, well, I know, like,
Where does lesser god fit in there?
The lords of hell.
Where does lesser god fit in?
Say again?
Where does lesser god fit in? Between demigod and god or below demigod?
A lesser god is more powerful than a demigod.
Okay, yes, so it is.
It's in between then, okay.
Yeah, it's demigod, lesser god, greater
then
god.
Greater god.
Yeah, and that's going by, you know, the deities and demigods. But, you know, demons and devils, it's kind of weird. But, you know, like, I can understand, like, for example, like Asmodeus or any of the archdevils. As long as they're on their plane, they are a god or whatever.
Of course.
But the moment they leave that place, because that's where their focus is at.
Right.
You know, because, it's weird how they work. Their relationship is not really covered too well in that sense.
Well,
I mean, look at Tiamat. Is she actually considered a god?
Yes.
Yes, she is a lesser god.
Yes.
She's considered a lesser god, yeah. Who are her worshippers, though?
There is a cult of Tiamat.
Yeah.
Right.
Evil dragons and whoever controls.
There's humans that worship Tiamat.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, you know, that's it. And she's on the first plane of hell, as a matter of fact. So,
yeah.
So yeah, it's kind of weird how that relationship is in. I liked how you brought up that part about the saints.
Yes.
Yeah.
And that's where I see, I'm not saying that every demon, it's kind of hard to separate, you know, the fantasy from what we got here in reality. But I just think that some of the just evil things, and for a person to become a demon, I think they have to go through that whole thing. Just do it the opposite way there, Vince. Mm-hmm. Like if, for example, I want to be a demon, well, that means you have to kill me. Oh, I'm sorry. Let me take that back. You have to be a devil, and you better hope the night hag that takes your little old larva takes it somewhere. They have to go through that whole process.
Oh, yeah.
Remember that?
Yeah. Okay, now I remember. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the same thing with people when they go to the abyss, that people that are chaotic evil, they go there as, what do they call them again, Nuperos or, because Lemurs are for the devils. For the chaotic evil side, the Nuperos.
Yeah, or Mains demons, I thought.
Oh, yeah, Mains. They're probably Mains. They have to go through that whole cycle of, you know, who gets separated and who does not, and eventually you get to be more powerful as time goes.
Right.
So, again, that's another process that you could change. Instead of going the immortal's path, you go the damned, or whatever you want to call them.
Yeah, and then through that, you also, like I said, if you're going to try to reach higher levels of demonhood, you're fighting every other demon who wants to get up there, too. So you're going to have to be more conniving and more evil than the next guy. So,
yep, exactly.
Yeah, because once you become that new demon, who's not to say that Orcus is going to come step on you?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, exactly, because everything, I don't know too much about the demon side. I know they have their rank structure, but I know in hell, their rank structure set up a very specific and certain way.
Oh, yeah. They have a very strong structure of rankhood in hell.
Yeah, structure, definitely a lot of structure there. And those bad boys cover and protect where they're at.
Yep.
Well, and they also don't care about if one gets slaughtered along the way, so.
Oh, no, of course not and everything, but the problem is that when you get to Pit Fiend, there's only one more step after Pit Fiend, and that's Archdevil.
Right. But as far as being the Dukes and whatever else, they don't care about them.
No.
Noticing you around that level, but.
Yeah, it's just weird. And, you know, there's two dragon magazines that cover the hierarchy of hell. Very interesting article.
Paizo has a great supplement for that also.
Oh, yeah, I saw that. That thing is awesome.
The Prince of Lies, Volume 1 or something.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact, if you all ever get the opportunity, take a look into the Horsemen of the Apocalypse.
Right.
For Paizo and read up on their whole history. Very impressive. Very impressive.
Now, let's talk about, is there anybody higher than the immortals or the demigods or the greater gods or the archdevils? Is there someone above that? Like in Forgotten Realms, they have Ael, who's the ultimate supreme god rides over the immortals.
I remember that.
Who is the ultimate god? Do you believe there is another ultimate power there, or just immortality is where it's at?
Gosh, I think it really just depends on the campaign and the DM and how you want to play it. I mean, I guess you could play it that way. You could have an overall, supreme being. And if I was going to do it that way, I would also have his opposite, too.
Yeah, of course.
So,
and of course.
And I'm just saying that because there is a issue of Dragon Magazine. I know I was in Best of Dragon Volume 1. Someone gave stats for Satan. So.
Satan? Did you say
that? I talked about that once. That was the time where, I had to actually call in on my cell phone. Yeah. So.
Did somebody say
that? That was a weird show.
it's funny how you bring that up and everything. And Vince, I would not have a overlord, both good or bad, if I am sticking with the immortal set. I think the moment that you achieve immortality, that's it. You're done. I think everyone then is equal. That you remain immortal until you can still be slain by another immortal or maybe, whatever, some other source. But, I would not use it. Now, if you do Forgotten Realms or Greyhawk or any of these other campaign settings, which have a lot of deities and God, yes, there would be a supreme overlord.
I think it was just like Forgotten Realms, like Vince said, that was introduced in second edition, that over God.
Right.
I don't know if I would personally want to play it that way. Mm-hmm. I kind of like in my campaigns, I like the polytheistic approach. Once you attain godhood, that's it. You're the immortal. You're one amongst the immortals and the gods, and there you go. There's nothing else after that. You just play dice with the universe.
Well, yep. The great Joe DM also had an answer to this as well.
Oh, really?
Yes, he had a step above immortality, which was called, I don't know where he got the name from, but he called it Mandarin.
Called it what?
Mandarin, he called it.
Oh, okay. Mandarin.
Yeah, he called them Mandarins, if for plural. And okay. They were supposed to be the supreme beings in the world, or the universe. And he never really explained, because he only used them maybe once or twice to keep us in check. But he never really explained to us what they were, other than that they were an ancient race of gods, is what he called them.
Oh.
So I was thinking maybe there's some type of alien or something.
Yeah, almost kind of going along that kind of line. A race of gods.
Yeah.
Huh, interesting.
And they were far more powerful than the most powerful immortal that we had, so.
Huh. I mean, who's above them?
I don't know. We never asked.
Bob is. All hail Bob.
It was funny, you brought up the thing that I remember seeing that Dragon Magazine where they talked about Satan and him stats.
Yeah.
Well, they don't have Satan. Well, Satan and Lucifer, I believe, are the same ones. Because yes. That's who Asmodeus and all of them overthrew from the ninth plane of hell.
Right.
But in D20, in the Tome of Horrors, Lucifer has 1,074 hit points.
In first edition, he has 666, I believe.
Yes.
Or 333 or something like that.
I know in Paizo, Asmodeus is the ruler of hell now.
Oh, yeah. He's nasty there. Yeah, he's absolutely disgusting, that's for sure.
Definitely. Okay. Pretty much that's it. Let's move on to some creature feature and talk about that.
That is not it.
Creature Feature Theater this week. So we've talked about immortals. We talked about not becoming an immortal. We talked about what happens when you're an immortal. Talk about demons, devils, named ones. What do your immortals fight when you're an immortal, though?
It's a good question.
Other than other immortals.
Yeah, other than fighting each other, I don't know. It's crazy.
Well, the Mensur box set for immortality has different types of demons that are like... I want to say they're like the things that you would find in the video game Diablo.
Okay.
Like screaming... They have demon, and then they have screaming demon, croaking demon, howling demon... whispering demon, and then it goes to named, like Orcus and then the Demigorgon, which okay. they list as the most powerful, I guess. So there's 5,000, I'm looking at the stats, it's like 5,000 points per head, so.
Jeez!
When Orcus is only 9,500 itself.
Yeah.
And I'm surprised that the armor class only goes down to negative 8. I would think it would go maybe negative 9, right?
Or negative 10, even.
And then you'd have, let's see, the elemental. The things that represent the elementals themselves. Not just, like, a water elemental. The water elemental.
Oh, okay.
Well, I think it's, like, real similar to how the Greek gods fought the Titans.
Yeah.
Yeah, there you go.
And that kind of format, I mean, you know, I would look at it like that.
There's one weird creature in here. It's called the Juniper.
Mm-hmm.
And it looks like a 20-sided die with tentacles coming out of it.
Sounds very Lovecraftian to me.
Yes.
See, that's where I would kind of go on an angle. What would an immortal fight? Oh. I think they would try to take on the Cthulhu mythos.
Try to take on
Cthulhu and the rest of the kitties.
The body has
to talk about ultimate evil and power in the universe. There you go. Take on the great old ones.
It's how do you pronounce a D12 word? Dodecahedron or something?
Dodecahedron?
Yeah, that's what it is.
Okay.
That's what it says it is. The body is the shape of a D12.
It's a Modron gone bad.
And arms extend from the center of the die other than for 12 sides. Wow. Let's see about my PDF.
Yeah, that's tough. That's really rough, honestly. I mean, what would immortals fight? And that's the whole issue of, you know, that's where a DM has to come up with some, you know, classy ideas on, you know, how will an immortal campaign, how will immortal characters, you know, set on from there on. Because, I mean, then that sort of becomes almost, you know, it just becomes a little bit too much. You know what I'm saying? I'm not saying it's outlandish or anything. It's just that it just gets to the point like, you know, just like I said, what more can I do? What more can I see? What more can I accomplish? How about the astral stalker that's on the front of the...
I was thinking of that. Was it astral juggernaut or whatever it's called?
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. The astral juggernaut. Yeah, whatever it is on the... what is that book called?
Manual of the Planes. Yeah.
Yeah. You would find monsters like that. But then again, that's one good reason to have a supreme being. You have been a naughty immortal. I'm going to take your powers away. You got to prove yourself, and now you're back immortal again.
Yeah. Well, we'll give you demigod, just, you know, be nice.
All right, we're just going to suck a few levels away back from you.
But again, it goes back to the point again of doing the 12 Herculean tasks.
Yep.
You know, and stuff like that and everything. I mean, it has to be very creative. I mean, what more can you do to a monster? I mean, you could have a 500 hit die hamster.
Space hamsters.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it just gets to the point where when is enough and everything. But
Or you could go this route. Maybe once you become immortal, you have thousands upon thousands of worshipers you have to keep track of. Remember the movie Bruce Almighty?
Yes.
There you go.
You know what? I would rather die.
See? Use that as a template. Okay, you're an immortal now? Well, you think it's all fun and games? Guess what?
Yeah, you just have to play. See, I want you to bring back a book, a notebook of every worshiper that follows your guide or worships you.
You got to make sure all your...
His race, his level, what does he do?
You got to keep track of all your worshipers. They're asking for things. They want, you know, my son just broke his leg. Can you help mend it? All this sort of stuff is coming up to you. Blah, 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 blah. shit.
All right, so immortality.
Like, wait a minute, I'm an immortal. I shouldn't have to work anymore.
No, all you got to do is I'm going to find the largest pile of green slime and I step in it.
Wow.
That's awesome.
So those are the creatures you can fight, but what about the creatures that are on the primordial plane that are immortal themselves, like liches or vampires?
They're no match.
No, I know they're no match for gods.
But yeah, that, mortals will destroy them. But the undead creatures have no impact.
Right, they have no impact, but they are considered immortal.
Well, I mean, they can be considered immortal. Eventually, they rot and they will disintegrate to nothing.
Yes. And eventually, their essence will merge with the negative material plane. Because remember, undead, their life force is derived from, at least this is how I remember it. I might be wrong in this, but I thought I read this in the Manual of the Planes. The undead derive their power from the negative material plane. So, once, you know, over time, like Will said, their bodies will deteriorate and their essence will eventually merge with the negative material. Unless you're one of those really high powerful ones like liches and vampires, there are probably ways around that.
So you're saying you're saying
blood and all that crazy stuff and everything. Yeah, liches here. Well, liches, we all know what happens to them. They eventually become demi-liches.
Mm-hmm.
I said Vector found a different way of doing that.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you're saying that Strahd's going to eventually just disintegrate and go away?
You know what? I don't think he'll ever disintegrate because of where he's at, you know, as far as Ravenloft is concerned, because now you have another element involved. You have another player involved in that whole cycle there that goes on with that.
Mm. Or, that's true.
How about Lord Soth? He's a Death Knight.
Well, I mean, no. Well, I mean, it depends on how you look at it, if he's there or not. I mean, right now he's not anymore, so...
But right, he's still a Death Knight, though.
But he's going to continue to be a Death Knight. I see some of them never... I mean, like a ghost, for example, you know, there's nothing left. The body's already gone.
Right.
I can see some of them living, you know, for maybe many thousands of years, but not eternity. But like I said, a DM could dictate otherwise.
That's true. Absolutely true.
This ghost is 9,000 years old. And you know, it's so funny that we talk about the immortals. The RMB3 Palace of the Silver Princess?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
You remember when they mentioned the word immortals?
No.
That's who that, remember at the very beginning that the green light and that lady comes out and explains the whole story of what's happened, the disaster, and she identifies herself as an immortal?
I don't know.
I didn't know that.
Yep, she is considered an immortal. Yep.
Huh.
So now this is from B3, which is a basic module. I have no idea if the immortals they're referring to infer to the Immortals box set.
Well, no, it doesn't.
That predates that.
That's so. What I'm saying. It does predate it. It's kind of funny how the word immortal comes back. Just, you know, just bringing it up.
All right.
But again, in that one there, this is so funny because they can't fight off that horrible curse. They let the mortals fight it off.
Right.
Which is kind of weird and everything.
All right.
But you know, like I said, hey, nothing wrong with them fighting aspects. Just like you mentioned before there, that the aspects could fight, you know, stuff like Tiamat or lesser versions of demons and so on like that.
Right.
The immortal itself couldn't fight, but an aspect can.
Hmm. All right, well, let's throw it out to people out there who are listening. Just give them some food for thought at the end there. And write us at rfistaff@gmail.com or give us a call 570-865-4210, the hotline.
Hotline.
Where Nick is standing by.
Intellect devourers are standing by.
No.
Don't worry, no one uses psionics anyway.
Oh, that's true.
The gods do.
I know.
Wah,
wah. If my character became an immortal, I would banish psionics.
Anyway, keep it original, keep it old school, and good night, everybody.
Night, everybody.
Bye.
for initiative.